First of all, thank you very much for this very generous introduction and the invitation, and especially alluding to Clemens Heller is for me very important. He was our master, as I always say. As a result of my last year's visit, I have a lot of admiration for this institution, and that is why I'm happy to participate in this anniversary. Admiration especially for what I would like to call staging scholarship, which means translating scholarship into memorable exhibitions. And that's not only publishing, but it's translating. Translating always changes the content. Well, however, as a former administrator, I have nothing to say about the program, but I will talk about organization of research, of course, from a European point of view, but with some experience in the United States. I'm very sorry, I was asked to have a PowerPoint presentation, but in such a beautiful place with so much beauty in this discourse, I am a little bit ashamed of the primitive way of making the power presentation. I just put some fundamental notions on the screen so that you can follow what I'm saying, and at the end some pictures. But I would like to begin with a personal anecdote before coming to my real subject, how to cope with the apparent contradiction between serendipity and administration in view of the design of a research institute. And at the end, I will come to an example of institution building in Romania linked to the general concern how to organize institutions in the humanities. So first, my personal anecdote. Many years ago, when I was still secretary of the Wissenschaftskolleg, I had to visit some academic institutions in New York. As it happened, Yehuda Elkana was there at the same time. He invited me for dinner, together with Harriet Zuckerman and Robert Merton. Since their common fellowship in the center in Stanford, they were good friends, but I felt intimidated. Robert Merton was already too great a giant for me when I was a student of law, daring to make some intellectual excursions into sociology. Structure, function, class, society as such, all these notions were too large for me as a legal scholar. I was full of admiration of those great thinkers as Weber or Merton, but their concepts were beyond my reach. Harriet Zuckerman represented for me the Mellon Foundation, the most generous funder of what at that time my ministry considered to be superfluous, the humanities. Yehuda Elkana, a philosopher of science and an extensive reader with good taste in many disciplines and cultures, was at that time permanent fellow at the Wissenschaftskolleg and a good friend. He introduced me to many fields and scholars I personally wouldn't have dared to approach myself, because I was a typical product of European education and its sense for hierarchy and separate disciplines. So I found myself in a small, rather noisy restaurant in the midst of Manhattan, in a company which I felt to be beyond my reach. I was prepared to listen and to admire, of course. However, before we were served, Harriet began to ask me questions. I began to explain the rationale of the Wissenschaftskolleg's ambition of institution building in Eastern Europe after the fall of the wall you were alluding to. As this was my passion, I felt encouraged to tell stories which happened to me in the course of this activity about misunderstandings occurring in the endeavor to support East European scholars in pursuing their own questions in this new internationally open environment. after a while, Robert Merton said that these stories were interesting. Why didn't I write them down? I uttered my usual excuse that I'm an administrator and not a scholar. I was completely taken by surprise. How could it be that this great scholar of sociology was interested in my very singular stories? But in spite of this immediate reaction, there was a long-term effect of this evening on me. I felt encouraged in my work for institution building in Eastern Europe and even dared to write on these experiences. Why do I tell this anecdote here? My personal encouragement is, in my view, a significant indication of an important advantage that the mentality of American scholars and administrators has over the academic life in continental Europe. In view of science administration, my job, this difference makes me focus on what I call institutional design. Particularly important in the humanities, where specific equipments and technical staff play a minor role. Equipments with, for example, in CERN, replace many elements of atmosphere. Such a focus doesn't deny the importance of the traditional instruments of the administrator. And here, there I have these normal instruments, personnel, money, funds, organization, procedures. But it emphasizes an aspect which is specific to science administration and often neglected. To paraphrase a dictum of legal realism about American law, limited, I think, to American law, science is what scientists do. Hence, the administrator should enhance their productivity, but should not be preoccupied by their final product. If the scholar has been well chosen and given optimal conditions, the administrator has done what is in his capacity. For political reasons, and however contrary to this kind of realistic attitude, output orientation is the underlying concept of many science administration procedures. For instance, if you look at technology transfer, or at indicators as norms for attributing funds. From this perspective, differences of mentality and academic life between the US and continental Europe are striking reasons for differences in attractivity. Germany's science policy strives at becoming like the US, or even better, a typical situation. When I was asked to help to build up the Wissenschaftskolleg, we were supposed to create Princeton an der Spree. Or another example, the Excellence Initiative had as an underlying expectation that the outcome would be a German Harvard. That was the original wording of Schröder. Now, we have 11 universities with the public label of excellence. They got more money. The presidents got more power, and research clusters and some scholars got financially really excellent conditions, I think better than normally in the US, even in the best universities. But however, when I talk to German scholars who have the choice to work here or there, I get a different picture. They mention openness for new ideas, curiosity for the unconventional, listening instead of preaching. Besides normal subject as the long way to tenure or two career patterns. Their accounts point to the continuous sway of the rigid academic atmosphere in Germany. One of them, for example, is professor of informatics, was attracted back in his home town, Berlin, with a generously endowed chair. But he's just unhappy. He has money and power, but lacks open discussion between equals, feels hindered by hierarchy and administration. Or Larissa Buchholz, a young sociologist of art. She was very well respected by all those in Germany with whom she worked, but she prefers to make career in the US. By the way, she helped me with critical remarks for this presentation. As a consequence of this academic atmosphere, many imaginative German intellectuals are attracted by journalism, exhibitions, museums, and even archives. So in a certain extent, to relink to Gaskell's presentation, nowadays museums become more attractive than academia. They even prefer insecure situations instead of being part of this business-like industry within German research institutions. But there are also more objective end indicators. Amongst the approximately 1,500 starting grant winners of the first four calls of the recently created European Research Council, there were 156 Germans working in other countries, not in Germany. This number is only comparable with Italy and its poor university structures. So apparently, atmosphere mentality counts, not only for me personally, as in the anecdote, but in general for scholars. Administrators call these aspects soft, épaisse les bras. In this, it is true that atmosphere is difficult to define in general, and even more difficult to create. It depends on many concrete circumstances and on persons. There is no general recipe to be applied. Science administration becomes a craft, responding to the needs of the scholars for their productivity in particular situations. Administration as a craft works on the conditions for the scholars, on input, not on output, on trust and not on control, on respect of the particularities of the situation and the persons, and concentrates on what I call institutional design. It is based on what I like to call an anthropological view, taking into account as many concrete circumstances as possible. That doesn't mean that everything goes Feierabend. Administration has to respect and to make respected the institutional conditions, especially in a state-driven system as in continental Europe. But its objective is the productivity of the scholar and not the obedience to outside criteria. For the institutional design, freedom and recognition are of great importance. Oh, I forgot to. Too early. Recognition is well embedded in academia in the form of career patterns, competition, prizes, etc. Freedom, on the contrary, is more difficult to organize. To a certain extent, it is a contradiction in itself to plan the unforeseen. Therefore, Robert Merton's term serendipity is very useful. From the point of view of the history of science, it is evident that new insights are often the result of unforeseen combinations of knowledge, not outside normal science, but partly liberated from the immediate normalizing pressures of academia. So in the sense of enhancing the productivity of scholars, administration is successful if it creates the kind of opportunities circumscribed by serendipity. And there are some of these ways of circumscribing serendipity. Institutes for advanced study are ideal places to do so. Robert Merton called them institutionalized serendipity. They offer space to allow for chance and sagacity. Chance is normally emphasized, but sagacity, I think, is very important. And to avoid as far as possible, the institutes can avoid as far as possible coercive rules. So for the administration of serendipity, I could tell you many examples based on my experience with the Wissenschaftskolleg. There are the Tuesday colloquia, the speaker of the fellows, no wine for lunch, the style of the house, fellows first. The style of the house is maybe a notion which can exemplify what I mean. It is a notion without any clear content. Its limits become only visible if something is disturbing, if an employee dressed indecently, or if fellows wanted to celebrate Christmas without taking into consideration Muslims and Jews amongst them. As there is no definition, no strict rules are avoided, or as there is no clear definition, strict rules are avoided, and nothing is excluded. It's a little bit like the notion serendipity. And this notion, a style of the house, is working because of its lack of clarity. It allows for argument in each case and puts only social pressure for justification on those shocking the others by their attitude. Or to give another example, the order and size of tables for lunch. We have about 40 fellows and some guests. In the beginning, community was emphasized. So there was one table in U form. But this was understood as a dominance of the rector. So small tables were arranged with four persons each. Then the interest in diverse situations became evident. So we established a structure with tables for four and six persons, and one table for eight, and one table for two persons. And this order became tradition, offering apparently the right compromise between pre-established order and freedom. And tradition is maintained as an institutional frame and only modified for strong reasons. Well, these are examples of setting conditions positively. However, administration of serendipity often implies struggling against overly coercive rules. They are proposed from scholars themselves, often by administrators. They come from inside and from outside. For this negative effort, I would like to give you finally some examples from the New Europe College. New Europe College. But I've... Ah, no, this was institutional design. Now it... I'm sorry, I'm not used to the PowerPoint. This was the Wissenschaftskolleg. You get an idea of the building and of the inside. And now we are at the New Europe College. Its founder was André Plechot, on the left. Before 1989, he was one of the well-known intellectuals in opposition to the Ceausescu regime. He became the first minister of culture under President Iliescu. When he left the government, the Wissenschaftskolleg could attract him as a fellow. He was impressed by this institution and asked us to help him to create something similar in Romania. For us and possible donors, a rather absurd idea. Incredible luxury in 92, in the Romanian situation of economic depression and political turmoil. He hadn't resigned without reasons. We urged him to be more specific. He described the ambition of the most interesting intellectuals as being concerned about the future of the country, but pursuing questions far from the demand of the regime, but also far from the usual Western style, working, for instance, on medieval Latin, the culture of the Romanian peasant, or on angels as André Plechot himself. With Yehuda Elkanah, I went to Bucharest, and after meeting some of these intellectuals, we were convinced, and then we trusted André Plechot. Trusted and discussed. The final outcome of the discussion with him was his idea to create an academic space of freedom and community for young Romanian scholars. Our common hope was that the next generation of professors in Romania in the humanities and social sciences would be imbued by this spirit, concerned for their country, but empowered to pursue the questions of their own choice, free from immediate local pressures of utility. The Institute should be embedded in international cooperation so that the fellows were exposed to general criteria of scholarly work, but free to choose their own giants on whose shoulders they would like to build their research. So this was the situation. Now, two examples where administration was necessary to protect serendipity. First, who should be the funders? In the beginning, it was evident that only foundations could engage in such an unconventional task. The initial funds in the form of the Newell Prize were provided by an equal engagement of the MacArthur Foundation and European funders. Then German and Swiss foundations joined forces. After a while, they could convince their governments that the New York College fulfilled an important role in renovating the Romanian system of research and higher education in the humanities and social sciences. The governments, as well as the foundations, conceived their contributions as an initial help in this difficult situation of transition, but with the perspective that on the long run, the Romanian government would take over. The new college was very successful and became an institution of national importance. So the foreign governments wanted to withdraw. The discussions with Andrei Pleșu made clear that institutional funding, which means the costs of the administration, from the Romanian government as well as from most of the private Romanian funders, donors, would threaten the freedom of the institution, expose it to immediate utility or even corruption. It was a long way to convince the actual funders that there was no other solution than to accept that under Romanian circumstances at that time, the understandable rule that the home country has to take over would destroy the particular opportunity for young scholars to evolve in an internationally open, free community, which allows for serendipity. My main task as an administrator was to convince the others that all other solutions would enable the wouldn't enable the institute to maintain its unique quality. My task was to maintain the procedure. The most difficult discussion was that the EU wouldn't help. EU funding is the easiest excuse in our continent for the single European governments to disengage. For me, it was evident that the EU programs were unable to support such a specific action. One of the great difficulties was to persuade the New Europe College to cooperate in these experiments in order to prove that this wouldn't work. The aversion against the administrative style of the EU program was very strong. They reminded Andrei Pleșu of the methods of socialist planning. We even had a public quarrel on this question. The lesson: for the administrator, providing serendipity often means rejecting funding opportunities that impose conditions which divert scholars from their promising intentions. Renouncing funds is sometimes necessary to protect the institution from wrong expectations. A second story on the humanities. Andrei Pleșu was invited to the Wissenschaftskolleg in the context of a most interesting group of well-known social scientists working on transition. Juan Linz was the convener who introduced the comparison with Spain and Latin America. We thought they would be interested in having an active politician among them. But when they heard that Andrei Pleșu was working on angels, they immediately lost interest. At the end of the year, Juan Linz invited for a conference on party formation as a condition of transition to democracy. Andrei Pleșu participated, but didn't say a word. At the end, Juan Linz asked him to comment. Instead of arguing with the contributions, André Pleschot gave a most interesting description of the fallacies of party formation in different East European countries. Astonished how a scholar working on angels could be so insightful on party formation, the others began to ask him questions. It became evident that working on angels implied working on the translators between God and the humans, on a world between Marxism and capitalism. I found out later that this was also the significance of his work for his students. However, the significance laid only in the subtext, and what he was really was doing was working on angels. And it was far away from the normal Western style of scholarship, so the interest dropped very quickly again. The selection of fellows at the New York College corresponded to this profile. It became an institute for the humanities, for interpretive hermeneutic scholarly work. Even though the funders tolerated this tendency, from time to time they asked nevertheless whether there are not more important areas of research, economics, law, sociology. Nevertheless, one of the main funders was the Stifterverband der Deutschen für die Deutsche Wissenschaft, the industry money channeled to academia. André Pleschot finally agreed to conduct an experiment and proposed to emphasize such professional disciplines in the next call for applications. Again, as administrator, I only insisted on procedure. The members of the selection committee, half Romanians, half foreigners, should continue to feel free to invite only the most promising candidates. The result was very convincing. There were a lot of applications, especially in economics, with little interest. The young scholars just opportunistically adapted themselves to the Western mode of economics. Under the historical circumstances of Romania, the best independent minds were apparently more attracted by humanistic disciplines than by mainstream social sciences. Maybe the necessity of the humanities is more evident in a situation of political turmoil and social distress. But this is a social science statement. So maybe in such situations it is easier to overcome this academic divide. For this, a last example demonstrating how serendipity allows for interconnectedness between empirical research, theory, emotion, social responsibility, and even beauty. A social anthropologist, Cosima Ruggini, working on Roma in the outskirts of Bucharest, really a rather frightening environment with these ugly socialist housing buildings, we asked how she feels in the luxury of the New Europe College. And now I have to show you a little bit the luxury. Her answer: the beauty of the place gives dignity to my work. The New York College, at the occasion of its 20th anniversary, will organize next year a conference on the necessity of the humanities and hopes for a wide audience for this message, how important the humanities are, and how important small, creative research environments are as the New York College and as the Bart Graduate Center. Thank you.